everyone. Welcome back to Patreon. October 1st, 2020. I'm so excited to have you here. I'm very excited to make this video. I actually filmed it 2 days ago as a pure reaction because that had been years since I had seen it. And I didn't have my audio come out right. And I'm so sad about that, but that's okay. It's a 5-minute video by Riley J. Dennis. It's called Your Dating Preferences Are Discriminatory, which again, the title in itself is meant to be sort of like clickbaity. On YouTube, as content creators, we have a choice. We can say things like, maybe your dating preferences are discriminatory, but that brings in less views because it doesn't hit that anger spot in a person. And so when she puts your dating preferences are discriminatory, she's basically asking for people to be preemptively pissed, which is why she has 138,000 dislikes on this video. It is her most disliked video. She became sort of famous for making content around feminism and in conjunction with everyday feminism. Disclaimer, I don't know her, but I've met her. We were together for a VidCon weekend. And she's a very nice person. Like, I really, really like Riley as a human. I think she's very nice. When she makes such a bold claim as your dating preferences are discriminatory, and she preferences, the word preferences, it's like insinuating, right? That she preemptively thinks she's right. And then the video itself can be very triggering for a lot of people because look, we already struggle to be humans. It's already so hard to be a human. And on top of that, it's really hard to sort of dig deep and wonder why we think certain things are attractive. And sometimes people just don't spend time thinking about that. They just know they like it. So for Riley to make this video, well, I can see why the internet backlashed. And I can see why she didn't wanna handle it either, because Riley doesn't really talk about it out loud. Most left tube, most SJW YouTubers, they never really tackle the criticism pushed on them. Some do, but most don't. And Riley's definitely no exception to that. Okay, so I'm just gonna play through the chunks of the videos. I'm gonna rewatch it right now. And then I'm just gonna add in my two cents.
Would you date someone who's trans? Would you date someone who's black? Would you date someone who's fat? Would you date someone who's disabled? Now, honestly, I don't know what your answer is to those questions, but I've met a surprising number of people who would say no to all or at least some of them. Their argument is that it's just a preference and that you can't control who you're attracted to.
I think, period, stop, sorry, 18 seconds in. So she does this thing where she'll say like, oh, people say it's just a preference. And then in the corner, it says, spoiler, it's not just a preference. So even though in the video she does, and I'll show it later, does say things like, oh, I'm not saying you should find these people attractive. By putting those things on, you are saying that. She's saying that if you don't find these groups of people attractive, there's something wrong with you. And I would say for all but except one of them, I just don't think that's true. Like the example she gives is black, trans, disabled, and fat. And obviously if you don't date black people, I don't really understand racial preferences in that regard. Like, I am so individual based as a human. I'm attracted to the individual, and there's no reason for me not to date like a black person or a white person or someone based off their skin color. But if you ask me based off culture, yes. But insinuating that every black person shares the same culture is so just not true. So in that regard, I don't think that really has any reasonable conclusion for me in my head. Like, I don't think that's a good enough reason not to date a black person. Anyways. But when it comes to being fat, disabled, or trans, like there are a lot of reasons people wouldn't date those three categories of human. Like a lot of really legit and valid reasons that come from a slew goals. Like the goal of your relationship could be severely impacted by those three things. Okay, so let's press start.
Most of the time that this is brought up, it's in regards to race. I'll link to a couple of really good videos in the description about racial dating preferences, but in this video, I want to talk about our other biases. Let's start with trans people. Would you date a trans person? Honestly? Think about it for a second. Okay, got your answer? Well, if you said no, I'm sorry, but that's pretty discriminatory. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying you're a horrible person who hates trans people. There was probably a time in my life when I said I wouldn't date a trans person, but since then, I've thought critically about it and changed my mind. I could sit here and show you photos of conventionally attractive trans people. There are definitely trans people who you would never know were trans unless they told you, because they pass for cis. And that might convince some of you, but I think arguing that you would only like a trans person if you didn't know they were trans is a poor argument. I think you could be attracted to any trans person, whether they pass or not.
So what she does here, which is why it pisses people off, is she says, I think you could be attracted to any trans person. And though I know this is Riley speaking from her heart, and she doesn't mean to insinuate that she knows every individual's heart, but the problem is that she assumes that her journey has been everyone else's, which I know some people accuse me of doing, but I promise you, unless you're living in my bubble, I don't expect you to act the way I act. That's why I'm always promoting conservative values or liberal values or leftist values, saying like, if those people want to live in that reality, I'm not gonna stop them. The difference is that Riley really wants the world to shift to her perspective. And that's why it triggers some people, because it feels the same way it felt when we were all in religious or in cult-oriented communities where people felt like this is the only way to be. It feels very, everyone must think my way. And if you don't, it comes from a negative place. And I don't buy into this. I don't buy into the idea that everyone would be attracted to the same kind of people like I'm attracted to. But with that said, there are plenty of reasons someone wouldn't want to date a trans person. And a lot of it is utilitarian. I know a lot of people forget there is a functionality to relationships. There is actually a goal-oriented way you might want to exist with another person. Actually, Indian Matchmaker points it out in a really beautiful way. I loved Indian Matchmaker. It really spoke to me, where the way they were finding partners and spouses was what did their resume look like? Because some cultures, myself included, they only believe chemistry takes you so far. And I actually believe this too. I believe your attraction to someone only takes you so far, that your compatibility is much more important for a long-term relationship. But if you're not looking for long-term, then yeah, you could find people attractive. Like I was with this trans person who's non-binary, and for months we were attracted to each other. It was really hot and sexy. We had great sex. But after a while, I lost attraction to them because, well, I'm not attracted to non-binary people. It was really hard for me to be able to be with their body in a comforting way, because when I'm with a body, like another human, I like to be very primal and just do what feels good. But because they were having gender dysphoria and their breasts would sometimes be a chest, or they didn't like the idea of their vagina being there, it was really hard for me to know what I was attracted to, because I am attracted to genitalia. I'm attracted to pussy. I'm attracted to boobs. That's why when people ask you, are you a boob girl or an ass girl, homie, like I got an answer for that. It's not that we're taking people and objectifying them down to their genitalia, but to say that humans don't have an attraction to genitalia. So I personally absolutely would date a trans-binary person. I have no problem with that. And I would have a preference for them going and undergoing like gender reassignment surgery, and I would have a preference for them living out their life in a way where society saw them as that gender binary man or woman, mostly because that's how I relate to the world, and I would like a partner who relates to the world in the same way I do. So if I dated a trans woman, like, I mean, I would date Janet Mock, because Janet Mock lives and breathes and is a woman, and like the way she expresses herself feels very similar to how I experience the world. So I think we'd get along really well, and that would match our compatibility factors. Okay, with that said, I'm rambling, so let's just.
I think the main concern that people have in regards to dating a trans person is that they won't have the genitals that they expect. Because we associate penises with men and vaginas with women, some people think they can never date a trans man with a vagina or a trans woman with a penis. But I think that people are more than their genitals. I think that you could feel attraction to someone without knowing what's between their legs. And if you were to say that you're only attracted to people with vaginas or people with penises, it really feels like you're reducing people just to their genitals. You're kind of objectifying them, but you're thinking of them more as genitals than objects. So I guess you're kind of genitalifying them?
You clever bitch. That's very funny. I would like to point out something that I think is sort of interesting. Dating is hard, because dating is the time when you should be your pickiest. Dating is an opportunity to literally be like, you spend way too much time at Starbucks. I'm out. Because to be honest, like, I could not date someone who gets Starbucks every day. Like, it's just, it's weird to me. It's not part of my personal habit. I think it's a waste of money. The amount of sugar in Starbucks is stupid. Like, I just don't see the point of being with somebody who literally has to get out of the house and drive to a Starbucks. The last time, I think I go to Starbucks maybe like twice a year. And it's not to say that people who drink Starbucks every day aren't good people. But when I think of my life, I think of my daily routine. I think about, okay, we wake up at 8, we have breakfast, we make breakfast from scratch, we have coffee, we have our glass of water every day, we start our day off with X, Y, and Z. And there's nowhere in my schedule where going to a Starbucks matters. Also, I am in a town where there's one Starbucks in a 300-mile radius. So again, it's kind of, for me, not a priority. I didn't move out in the middle of nowhere. So, you know what I mean? It's just not important to me. So again, when you're dating, I feel like dating is the perfect time to be picky over the smallest shit. It's when you've it's when you're married or chosen a life partner and things go not the way you predicted that you have to step up to the plate and figure out, you know, are we sticking through the hard times?
My point is, we have implicit biases that we were raised with or that we developed over time, and they can be hard to get rid of. And I think this can be especially prominent within the queer community. Gay men often pride themselves on being disgusted by vaginas, and the same goes for lesbian women with penises. It's difficult because some queer people have built their sexual identities on these repulsions, but I don't think they're innate at all. If you met someone who was extremely attractive, had a great personality, but didn't have the genitals that you wanted, you might be surprised to find that it isn't a deal breaker. As someone who is trans and gay, sometimes people ask me, with a very accusatory tone, if I would date a girl with a penis. Because there's this stereotype that trans lesbians are just predatory cis men creeping on cis women. But the thing is, I absolutely could be attracted to a woman with a penis. I could be attracted to any woman, cis or trans. If I find you attractive, I don't care what you have down there. But we know that sexual orientations are more innate than learned. They're more nature and less nurture. Gay conversion therapy has been proven not to work, but you can unlearn your own prejudices. It just takes time and conscious effort. And the way that we talk about potentially dating trans people has a lot in common with the way we discuss other preferences. Saying that you're not attracted to fat people isn't innate. It's informed by a society that tells you that being thin is ideal.
Okay, so this is the other part where people had a really hard time. It's not society that tells you you shouldn't date fat people alone. It's actually evolution. To say that we're not animals, a part of the earth, to say we haven't evolved over millions of years to adapt to be the genetics that continues on, to say that we don't look at women with certain body types as potential mothers because of the way they've produced, like hormone-wise, the way their bodies have produced over time, is sort of not science, sorry. I really appreciate social studies, and I understand that gender studies teaches that a lot of it is socialized, like gender's a construct and all these things. But I believe we're human animals. Like, I believe I am a part of the earth. I believe I have evolved over time. I do not believe in Adam and Eve. I do not believe this is how humans have always looked. I believe in Neanderthals. I believe in them mating. I believe in the recent girl who was found in the cave, with a bunch of animals that show she has Neanderthal and human DNA. And so for me, like, I don't personally subscribe to any that most things in society are a simple construct because I believe in evolution. And I'm not saying science has all the answers. I'm not saying that. Please don't think I'm saying that. But I'm saying that certain things are knowledgeable. Certain things we have the knowledge on, and we should move our life based off of the knowledge and accept that we have preferences for how we exist and process reality. So I personally adhere to the belief system that people choose their realities and that there's one shared physical reality, right? We're all on planet Earth. But then how we choose to examine or process reality could be subjective. And that's why I think belief is subjective, while truth is contextualized. So for Riley, her truth might be different from my truth, but our knowledge base has to be the same because that's where the facts come in. So I really have a problem with this particular part. And again, I know I've been very critical of the health knowledge that we are pushing on people in regards to bigger bodies, because though I support people's ability to be bigger, absolutely, I don't think we need to lie in order to justify the body. I think you should be able to just be fat if you want to be fat. I think it's bullshit that you have to justify it. I think it's bullshit that society needs you to support yourself with some sort of scientific health fact. No, I have a body and I choose how to be in that body, how to live in my vessel. I see the bodies as a vessel, your ship. And if you want to keep your ship any way you want, you should be able to do that. And I think people should be able to have a preference over whether or not they're attracted to those vessels. I mean, I remember a bunch of sex positive feminists / you know, gender studies people were saying that we should promote more fat porn in pornography. And I was like, oh, that's kind of nice that fat people can see themselves on screen. So I subscribed and paid for some fat porn so I could see what was going on. And honestly, I'm not into it, but it also doesn't sell. Even if over 60% of America is considered like fat and obese, I'm very surprised that more of it's not selling. But I'm not, because I think our evolutionary brains speak for themselves. I think it's very hard to deny that we have a biology, to deny that we have inherent traits, and to deny that we have inherent desires. And I think as human beings, you can absolutely be larger and bigger than your instincts, as you should be. And I think that's what Riley's really saying. I think she's saying that we can process that we are shaped by our society, which I agree, and that we can be bigger and better than it, but I feel like she struggles to admit that humans do have a biological drive and evolutionary need to procreate with certain bodies, to be attracted to certain bodies, and I think that's the part where we all disconnect pretty hard.
In the media you consume is bombarding you with messages that skinny is beautiful and fat is ugly. And even the nicest of people absorb these messages to some degree. But again, if you find someone attractive and really enjoy spending time with them, there's no reason why their weight should be a factor. Especially since we know that the relationship between weight and health is extremely complex, and you really can't make any moral judgments on a person based on their weight.
Really fast, I don't think you should make a moral judgment based off of people's weight unless you understand sort of the context of that person or maybe some of their choices. And I think in general, I think that's where people get a little offended. And I think you should be offended. Like, don't be offended. But I think that that is the part in society that people need to understand. Like, I would never go after a fat model. Like, I would never post on her Instagram, like, oh, you're fat, you should lose weight, it's unhealthy. Like, what? I don't care. That's her business, not my business. Like, that, I just don't see a reason why you would comment. So I think what they're fighting is the people who take their time and think it's their job to go on other people's content forums and post their opinions about how they should change. People do that to me too. I just ignore those people. What they're trying to say is, this is hard for me to process and I would like you to change for me. Actually, one of you in particular saw my Tess holiday video where I was smoking my cigarette, and you asked me not to smoke in my video because it triggers your cravings. No, 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 grow up. If you have an addiction to cigarettes and watching a girl smoke cigarettes on a video triggers your own cravings, you need to get your shit under control and not watch the video or just listen to it on audio. But to come onto my channel and to assume that it's like your issues should change how I make content, that is no different than the religious people who think we should change because it offends their God. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Just no, 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 no.
And lastly, let's talk about disabled people. Disabilities come in a very wide range, from being deaf to being in a wheelchair to only having one arm. And I think it's pretty ridiculous to say that you couldn't be attracted to any person who has any of those disabilities. Disabilities can happen to anyone. Someone you're extremely attracted to today could become disabled tomorrow. And that shouldn't make your attraction to them disappear. Though if it does, it might not be because of them, but rather because you have some preconceived ideas about disabled people that are just inaccurate and harmful. Unsurprisingly, this is another case of the media telling you that a certain group isn't attractive. Disabled people are rarely romantic leads. Their stories in movies and TV shows are often tragic, but that doesn't reflect the reality that disabled people can be happy and have dating lives and be attractive. Now, if you're not attracted to someone, you're not attracted to them. I'm not going to tell you that you have to be attracted to this fat person or that trans person or that disabled person, but the more you work at unlearning your own prejudices, the more you'll be able to see people from these groups as people rather than tired stereotypes. Unlearning our own biases doesn't happen overnight, and I don't have a step-by-step instruction guide for you. But I think if you can accept that these prejudices exist in all of us, even you, you can identify them when they come up and work to change how you think about them. It will most likely be a long, slow process, but I think it's worth it. Because these dating preferences are ultimately harmful to people who don't fit into your box of what a conventionally attractive person looks like. It makes people feel isolated, alone, and unwanted to hear that they're universally unattractive to people. I don't think there's anyone out there who somebody doesn't find attractive. We're sold this image of the conventionally attractive person, but in reality, all kinds of people around the world are constantly dating, having sex, finding people attractive, getting married. It's not only the conventionally attractive who find love or have sex. So by working on ourselves to dispel that idea, we can make the world a more welcoming and loving place for everybody, no matter how they look. This video is a part of—
Okay, so funny enough is she kind of contradicts herself at the end, sort of, where she says, like, people who are unconventional are finding love. So why did she feel a need to make the video if they're already getting married and finding love? And the truth is, when it comes to disability, is there's, like I said, a utilitarian reason, like, people wouldn't necessarily want to be with someone who's disabled, depending on how it goes. Like, I know people who are disabled so they can't walk up and down stairs. That's hard. I know people who are disabled from the neck down. I know people who are disabled mentally. I know people who are disabled on a spectrum. And so there has to be sort of an ethical quandary about who you can date, if it's ethical to date someone with a mental disability and how that looks, and if they have the ability to consent. But when it comes to physical disability, there was a man I knew who got married to my neighbor, and he had no legs, and he had a business as a swim coach. And I know what you're thinking, like, a swim coach? What? And the cool thing about him is that he was in super good shape. He owned his own car and his own house. And yes, it was built to complement his disability, and it never owned him his disability, and that was attractive. And honestly, I was like, I would get me some of that. And even people asked in the neighborhood, like, oh wow, I'm surprised she married someone with no legs. I was like, why? Like, he's functional. And that's the thing, is I know so many people are in pain and they're hurting because their disabilities are causing them to be not functional. But to say that dating isn't for a purpose of having a life you imagine, therefore you have to have a partner that you kind of imagined in that life, I think is sort of doing a disservice to the fact that a lot of us have goals and relationships have to be complementary. So if my goal is to be an avid hiker or skier, maybe somebody with legs wouldn't work out. It's not that that person isn't human. It's not that we can't love that person, but maybe they just aren't compatible with me because of their disability. Now, with that said, I dated a deaf girl once. I have this thing where when I try something new, I try to do a lot of it to make sure I really don't like it or that I do like it. So I tried online dating when I lived in Seattle and I went on 11 OkCupid dates. I tried Tinder. It was weird. I didn't like it. So I did OkCupid and I went on 11 dates and I only date girls on the internet. I don't date boys on online apps and things. No offense. I went on a date with this girl who was a world traveler. She was amazing, beautiful, gorgeous, just like, oh my God, so many cool things. But she was deaf. And we had our first date basically writing to each other in a notepad. And it was a cool date, but I looked at her and I realized, and I told her, I was like, hey, I really like you, but girl, I need to be able to fall asleep at nighttime with my partner holding them and talking into the darkness. And I can't do that with a deaf partner. I talk way too much. I talk a lot. Obviously, I do YouTube for a living. So for me, I'm thinking about the functionality, not her. I'm not thinking about her. I'm thinking about the reality of what do I imagine our life to be like. And yes, if I fell in love with somebody who eventually went deaf, so I had to, you know, we had to sign to each other, that's different. Again, when you've already had an established relationship where you love somebody and something happens where they're not the same person, there are plenty of reasons to get divorced, and I think depending on how much they change, that could still validate the divorce. But in general, I kind of like the idea of just being like, yeah, we'll take it as we come. Like, I don't want to get married unless that person is going to stay with me through the hard times and the good times and is going to be positive and optimistic about those changes that happen. I understand that if I get married, like, you know, what if I can't produce children in the way that I think I can? Because, you know, I'm 31 and I haven't tested it before, and that could be a problem. Or what if I do break a leg or have to get amputated or any of those things? I think about that all the time, and I'm hoping to always become bigger than the things that I'm being told would stop me from being successful. And I think that's really what Riley is trying to say. She's trying to say that maybe the people you assume can't do things can. But here's the thing, you gotta be one of the people who do the things. Because right now we're living in a generation of people that allow their disabilities and allow their challenges to put them in a defeatist mindset. As much as people like to say, like, I own my bodies, I own my disabilities, people are not doing that anymore. I grew up in the 90s and 2000s where we would have people with disabilities come to our schools and talk about how they've overcome and done amazing things and had great lives. But that's not the conversation that's happening anymore. And I don't know if you understand, you wanna talk about how media has influenced people? It does not help when you've got leftist bread tube or all these people who are always talking about their disabilities in the most depressing and anxiety-inducing way. So many people are so eager to tell their stories on the internet about how hard their life is and how, yeah, you know, I'm a vulnerable adult and all these things, but still want to be treated like grown people. And you can't. You can't be a person who says, I'm a vulnerable adult, and then be a person who says, but I want complete control over my life. You can't be a person that asks for extra handouts, extra fundraising, a person who says, this is a disabled group of people who needs help, and then claim that you're just as capable as a person who isn't disabled. And that's, I think, the conundrum that's happening is, instead of owning that you might have a few shortcomings, you know what I mean? Either overcoming or acknowledging, like, these are my limitations, but I'm trying my best. Like, I knew a girl in BDSM who, I forgot what it's called, what she had. I think it was like maybe even a form of MS, but basically her legs were dead. Her legs were useless. So she used to walk around on crutches, and she drove her own car. She was in BDSM, and she had relationships. And even though she was disabled, she was functional. She was very determined to own her life. And that was attractive, and that's what attracted people to her. And she did always push herself. She pushed herself to the brink, and that's what made her successful, and that's what's attractive. That is what is key. I think people are attracted to people who kick ass. I mean, how could we not be? Look at the way they do it. It's just so motivational and amazing. So yeah, I don't think Riley's a bad person. I think it's pretty clear she intends the best things for society. But I also think it's clear that she thinks she has the answers for everyone versus just her people. I think Riley's belief systems work really well in leftist circles, but I don't think they make any sense to anyone who's outside of it. And I think that's fine as long as she accepts that that's the reality. They think they have the answers for everyone, and they just don't. They have the answers for themselves. And I think that's something we just have to accept about ourselves as people. And I hope as I make content that you guys never think I have the answers for everyone. I just know that if you're conservative, this is how you do things. If you're liberal, this is how you can do things. And I try to give advice based off of where that person is coming from and what their goal is as a human. And I think if we do that, maybe the world would be a little bit of a smoother place. All right, thanks for watching. Have a great day, and I'll see you next video. Bye.